wonderful world of Disney. This week, from the wonderful world of make-believe, an adventure in color and Math Magic Land. And now your host, Walt Disney.
The world we live in would look pretty dull if Mother Nature used a black and white palette and painted only in shades of gray like this. But before we brighten things up with color in this show, it might be appropriate to recall those times when the movies, too, had their gray days, way back in the old silent era. In fact, when the animated cartoon was created, nobody gave color a second thought. Giving life to a static comic strip character was magic enough. And as for sound, well, if a cartoon character had something to say, he said it like this. If you wanted music, well, you could only pray that the theater organist would play the right tune at the right time. That was the situation when I first stepped into the entertainment world some 40 years ago. Then came a very important breakthrough. Steamboat Willie was the first sound film in the animated cartoon field. And it couldn't have happened to a nicer guy than Mickey. Now the whole world of music could serve as a creative inspiration for our stories. And so in 1929, the Silly Symphony was born. Crude and primitive, but we had sound and music. However, one vital dimension was still missing, color. It was an impractical dream, something at the end of the rainbow. But in our business, dreams have a way of coming true. Color does brighten things up, doesn't it? When Technicolor made the breakthrough with the first three-color process, I wanted to cheer. Flowers and Trees was the first full-color film to hit the motion picture screen. It made quite a splash. Of course, by today's standards, this early effort seemed limited. But here is how we handled a similar subject a few years later in Fantasia. Of color begins. For 30 years now, we've been living in this exciting world of color. These are earth colors, a gift from Mother Nature who took millions of years to make them. Others are created by the magic miracle of modern chemistry. With such basic pigments as these, we can make all the colors of the rainbow. Girl, just a moment. Haven't you gotten a word? We're in full color. Oh, well, a bit of color magic will fix it. Bibbidi, bobbidi, blue. I must have said the wrong words. Let's see, I know. NBC, color TV. Well, that's more like it. Yes, color gives us an exciting dimension to add to our programs. For the past 7 years, we've presented our shows in black and white. Those of you without color television will continue to see our programs as you always have. And we will continue to entertain you with stories which will cover a wide field of new and exciting subjects. From fact and fantasy to tales of adventure, from music and dancing to people and places. But to come back to the subject of color, it is such a fascinating topic that we've invited the world's foremost authority to throw some light on the subject. He's a renowned scientist, lecturer, psychologist, world traveler, my old friend and longtime associate, Professor... Here we are, Professor Ludwig von Drake. So here now to tell you all about the wonderful world of color, Professor von Drake himself.
Good evening. Now, the first thing I would like to say is, look out! That crazy, where are you going with that thing? Oh, look. How do you like that? I thought it was a motorcycle coming at me, and it was the spotlight was hitting me because I'm the professor going to give a lecture. Well, anyway, let me introduce myself. How do you do? I am Professor Ludwig von Drake, and today we are going to discuss the wonderful world of color. In fact, I got it all written down here in black and white. Black and white. But I needed some notes in color. That's what I really need. This whole program is being seen in color. Huh. And that's a lie. You know that's a lie. Because only the people with color TV sets is seeing it in color. Well, all right. Now for the occasion, I wore this vest, especially. For you people with colorblind TV sets, I'm going to describe this beautiful vest to you with all the colors. Now, there's red, there's blue, there's orange, there's jade, green, there's lemon yellow, and there's pot roast. Pot roast? Pot roast isn't a color. Oh, brown, that's what it... Oh, when you see this in gorgeous full color, you know something? You're gonna get sick. I can't even stand it. All right, now to the subject. This is the subject. I forgot I got carried away with all. Oh, yes. Color. That is the subject we're going to discuss. Now, first of all, there are three primary colors. Red, yellow, and blue. And with these, you can make any color you want. Red and yellow make orange. Blue and yellow, and you got a green thumb. You should see my petunias. Now, you mix them all together, and they spell muddy. And then you got black. And that's exactly the way things were in the very beginning of time. Black. Man was completely in the dark about color. Why? Because he was stupid. That's why. He didn't have a color expert like me to teach him. This kid had to learn everything the hard way. And when he was cold, he turned blue. When he discovered fire, he discovered a nice, warm red. And then when he found out you mix yellow with blue, it gave him a very nice green. So green became man's favorite color. Even today, you give a man plenty of green stuff and he's got no problems. But you give man a green steak and, well, that's a horse of a different color. In fact, it's a duck. Of a different color, you want to look at it that way. So, you see, color can even affect your appetite. Now, it's altogether different if you're a dog. Are you a dog? All right, if you're a dog, will you please leave, because we're going to discuss you. All dogs watching this program will now leave. Did you leave? They left. I gotta tell you the truth. I said that because I don't want to hurt the dog's feelings. You see, dogs don't know this. We know this, we scientists. Dogs is colorblind. You see, they only see in black and white. In fact, you know, they don't even care if a steak is green, blue, purple, or plaid. Well, anyway, this all proves one important thing. Don't buy your dog a color TV set. Now, my dog sits at home watching the old black and white set, and he's perfectly happy. And I want you all to be happy just like my dog. And so, especially for you people who are watching me in black and white, I'm going to sing a colorful little song. And when you hear this, you're gonna know that they don't call me Elvis von Drake for nothing. All right, hit a note. Day. Oh. I was reading a fly spec. Get off of there, you cookie fly, you. All right. That's the whole introduction? And you're supposed to do it in the right key, too, isn't that right? I'm blue as I can be, green with jealousy, yeah. green but and be blue. Did you hear that note? It came out blue. All right, all you cool cats. Now back to the lecture. Now you know something? Without light, there is no color. All right, turn out the lights. Hey up there, wake up. There, you see? Nothing. Without light, it's nothing. And without light, how do we know what this is? A tennis ball or a rutabaga? So, now let's have some light on the subject. Aha! An orange, maybe. Maybe. A large plum? No. A head of lettuce? No. Now, we put all the colors together. Red, blue, and green, which gives white. I'm surprised. Isn't you? Of course you are. Now we can see what we got. A juicy red apple. Oops. That just proves one thing. Never eat an apple in the dark. Oh, it's raining. Call off the lecture. Wait, all right, give them a rain check. We come back. Goodbye. And then, oh, what am I saying? Look at it. That was no rain. That was the spectrum. You see the flashing off of my spectacles. And that breaks up the light into a color spectacular. It's like a rainbow. Now, let's see what's at the end of the rainbow. Gold, a pot, no, a piano, of course. Now, the human brain, and that's located in the head, you know, somewhere, sees only one octave of color. But even with our little color octave here, we can mix 10 million different shades. And I ought to know because I counted every one of them just before the program. Now, for a little color harmony. For the first time on TV, Van Drake will play for you in color. I call it a spectrum song because it's about that. So now we're gonna do the song for you. Red, yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, yellow, orange, red, 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 yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, yellow, orange, red, red. Blend them up and what do you get? Cerise, chartreuse, and aqua, mauve, beige, and ultramarine, and every color in between. Yes, canova, sontin, bow, wow, color has its harmony, and just like I have said. Red, yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, yellow, blue, purple, purple. Wait a second, what am I saying? It's supposed to finish with red. Red. Now, all right, we know that everybody don't have television sets with color, so we're gonna do a version for them. We don't want you to feel left out of this. Here's for you. Black, black, gray, white, gray, 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 white, gray, white, gray, gray, white, black, 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 gray, white, gray, 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 white, gray, 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 black, black. All right, now you're happy, you don't feel left out? Now I want to get back to my song. Blend them up and what do you get? Cerise, chartreuse, and aqua, mauve, beige, and ultramarine, and every color in between. Whoops, hey, hey, ho, say, say, say. Color has its harmony, and just like I have said, red, yellow, green, red, blue, 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 red, purple, green, blue, purple, red, and white, and green, and red, and red, and blue, and it. Ooh, what a show-off. How do you like that guy? I'm gonna let you in on something. Confidentially, he dyes his feathers. All right, now, we come to the time for the question and answer period. And if there's anything at all that you wanna ask me, you call me up and we discuss it, because this is the disgusting part of the program. All right, everybody, the number to call is Rainbow 2800. Hello? Yes? Hold it. All right. Yes? What do you want? All right. You got the wrong number. All right. Fire department, you got a fire in your house. Oh, that's very interesting. Well, I would say run, run, whatever you do. No, Fido, I'm sorry. You're a little late. We all out of the stakes. One moment, please. Hold the line. Be right with you, madam. Hello? Yes? And 2 dozen what? No, I, lady, you got the wrong number. All right. Stand by. You what? You want to know how color TV works? Well, it works very good. What do you want? What are you bugging me with calling me every couple of seconds? Oh, I'm sorry. You want a technical explanation? Huh. I don't like the wise guy calling up trying to stump the Professor Van Dyke, is he? Well, now it's all done with mirrors. Now, everybody knows you have a camera. Now, the picture comes in here and is broken down into three primaries, and it's picked up by the election tubes after the primary. It goes on, and there's a little governor in there that gives it a little push in the side, and it takes two and it changes into wolves. And then they fly like little homing peacocks through the air, and the wires in your set pick the color out of the air and throw them into the inside. Oh, 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 be sure never to touch the green wire with the blue, or vice versa. That can be dangerous. Oh, you don't know. I know. Oh, I know. Believe me, I found out. And that's how I became an expert. Now, as you see, the red tube picks up red. The blue picks up blue. Blue, they picks up the blue. Blue, they picks up the blue. And green, of course, picks up pickles. Look at that little honey there. I was wondering where I put that thing. Oh, look at that pickle. This is a real dilly. What happened to the Swiss cheese? I had in here a Swiss cheese set. Now, let's see. Did I forget anything? What's this? This doesn't even belong here. Besides, what do you want to bother your head about all this technical stuff? It's very simple. All you do, you turn this little knob, and you got your picture. See? That's all. All right, come on. You turn the little knob, and you got the picture. All right, I turned the knob. Didn't I turn the knob? What are you doing with that? It's... I guess it takes a time to warm up. I don't know what it is. Oh, this is murder. There's the picture.
Exciting and fascinating to all of us. But there is another equally fascinating world, and that is the world of mathematics. Well, most people think of mathematics the way we use it here in our color laboratory as weights and measures, as equations and exact formulas. And of course, the right proportions are very important too. What I'm trying to say is that mathematics isn't all attractive figures. Will you kids get out of here so I can finish my speech? Thanks. What I mean is, mathematics isn't all theories of numbers and quantities. It can be a very fascinating subject. In fact, you'll find it in the most unlikely places. So now, another of our associates will guide us on an adventure in Mathematic Land.
What kind of a crazy place is this?
Equal to 3.1415926535897477,
etc., etc., etc.
Hello, Donald.
That's me. Where am I?
Mathematic Land.
Mathematic Land? Never heard of it.
It's the land of great adventure.
Well, who are you?
I'm a spirit, the true spirit of adventure.
That's for me. What's next?
A journey through the wonderland of mathematics.
Mathematics? That's for eggheads.
Eggheads? Now hold on, Donald. You like music, don't you?
Yeah.
Well, without eggheads, there would be no music. Come on. Let's go to ancient Greece, to the time of Pythagoras. The master egghead of them all.
Pythagoras?
The father of mathematics and music.
Mathematics and music?
Ah, you'll find mathematics in the darndest places. Watch. First, we'll need a string. Stretch it good and tight. Plunk it. Now divide in half. Plunk again. You see? It's the same tone, one octave higher. Now divide the next section. And the next. Pythagoras discovered the octave had a ratio of 2 to 1. With simple fractions, he got this. And from this harmony in numbers developed the musical scale of today.
By God! You do find mathematics in the darndest places.
You can imagine how excited Pythagoras was when he shared his findings with his pals, a fraternity of eggheads known as the Pythagoreans. They used to meet in secret to discuss their mathematical discoveries. Only members were allowed to attend. They had a secret emblem, the pentagram. Let's see what the topic is for today.
Shh.
Greeks, the Pythagoreans, with her mathematical formula, came the basis of our music of today. Friend Pythagoras who discovered that the pentagram was full of mathemagic. The two shorter lines combined exactly equal the third. And this line shows the magic proportions of the famous golden section. The second and third lines exactly equal the fourth. Once again, we have the golden section. But this is only the beginning. Hidden within the pentagram is a secret for creating a golden rectangle, which the Greeks admired for its beautiful proportions and magic qualities. The star contains the golden rectangle many times over. It's a most remarkable shape. It can mathematically reproduce itself indefinitely. All these rectangles have exactly the same proportions. This figure also contains a magic spiral that repeats the proportions of the golden section into infinity. To the Greeks, the golden rectangle represented a mathematical law of beauty. We find it in their classical architecture. The Parthenon, perhaps one of the most famous of early Greek buildings, contains many golden rectangles. Proportions are also found in their sculpture. In the centuries that followed, the golden rectangle dominated the idea of beauty in architecture throughout the Western world. The Cathedral of Notre Dame is an outstanding example. The Renaissance painters knew this secret well. Today, the golden rectangle is very much a part of our modern world. Modern painters have rediscovered the magic of these proportions. Indeed, this ideal proportion is to be found in life itself.
Boy, oh boy, oh boy. This is mathematics. I got mathematical figures like that.
Donald.
Get me quiet.
No, no.
Ideal proportion.
Not quite. No, I'm afraid not. Well, we can't all be mathematically perfect.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, I do want to do it.
Now that you're all pent up in a pentagon, let's see how nature uses this same mathematical form, the petunia. The star jasmine. The starfish. The wax flower. There are literally thousands of members in good standing in nature's Pythagorean society of the star. All nature's works have a mathematical logic, and her patterns are limitless. Proportions of the golden section are often found in the spirals of nature's designs. The profusion of mathematical forms brings to mind the words of Pythagoras. Everything is arranged according to number and mathematical shape. Yes, there is mathematics in music, in art, in just about everything. And as the Greeks had guessed, the rules are always the same. Enjoy your geometrical journey?
Gee, Mr. Spirit, there's a lot more to mathematics than 2 times 2.
That's right, Donald. And you can find mathematics in games, too.
Games? Oh, boy.
Let's begin with a game that's played on squares.
Checkers?
No, chess.
Chess?
A mathematical contest between two minds. It's a game that has been enjoyed for centuries by kings and commoners. In fact, Lewis Carroll, a famous mathematician with a literary mind, used chess as a setting for his classic tale, Through the Looking Glass. Alice found herself face to face with a none too friendly group of chess pieces.
Good heavens, what's this?
On my soul, it appears to be a lost pawn.
I'm your pawn. I'm Donald Duck.
He says he's Donald Duck.
Preposterous.
Or it could be an Alice.
Alice?
No, no, no. It's a lost pawn.
Lost pawn? Stop that pawn!
Mr. Spirit!
Chess is a game of calculated strategy, and since the board is geometrical, the moves are mathematical. Game is over.
That's very interesting. What's next?
Practically all games are played on geometrical areas. The baseball field is a diamond.
A diamond!
And without mathematics, we couldn't even keep score. Football is played on a rectangle divided by yard lines. Basketball is a game of circles, spheres, and rectangles. Even hopscotch has its multiple squares.
What's next? Get out of reach?
No. A mathematical game played on a field of two perfect squares, using three perfect spheres, and a lot of diamonds. In other words, billiards.
Oh, boy! That's for me!
You know the game, don't you, Donald?
Of course! The cue ball has to hit the other two balls. Like this.
Now let's see how an expert at three cushion billiards uses his head.
Three cushion?
Yes. The cue ball not only has to hit both the other balls, but it must contact at least three cushions before it hits the final ball. It's an expert to make several shots in succession. One, two, three, four, five, six.
Wow! That was not a good shot.
Luck? No, it's skill. For this game, you have to know all the angles. Striking the cue ball low, so it'll spin backwards. Hitting the ball on the right side will make it hug the rail. These trick shots take a lot of practice.
He missed that.
One, two, three.
What's the mathematical about that?
Oh, this game takes precise calculation. He figures out each shot in his head. He could play it like this, but it calls for quite a bit of luck. There is a better choice. For this, he uses the diamond markings on the rail as a mathematical guide. First, he figures the natural angle for hitting the object balls. And then he finds that his cue ball must bounce off the number three diamond. Next, he gets ready for the shot, and he needs a number for his cue position. This calls for a different set of numbers.
Very confusing, isn't it?
Not when you get the hang of it. You see, the cue position is four. Now a simple subtraction. Three from four is one. So if he shoots for the first diamond, he should make it. It's called playing the diamond system. Natural angle two. Cue position. 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5. 2 from 3.5 is 1.5. So, shoot halfway between the first and second diamonds.
There's nothing to it. The next one. Let's see now. If I hit it here, it'll bounce there and go here. If I hit it here, 4.5 minus 3, 3.5 plus 4 added to 2, so divided into, I guess I should shoot about here.
No, no, Donald. There's no guesswork to mathematics. It's quite simple. Natural angle for the hit, 2. Cue position, 3.5. How much is 3.5 minus 2?
1.5.
You're making it tough for yourself, Donald.
How do you like that for mathematics, Mr. Spirit?
Wonderful, Donald. And now you're ready for the most exciting game of all. And the playing field for this game is in the mind. Oh, look at the condition of your mind. Antiquated ideas, bungling, false concepts, superstitions, confusion. To think straight, we'll have to clean house. That's more like it. A nice clean sweep. This game is played with circles and triangles. Think of a perfect circle. A perfect circle. Perfect circle. Perfect. Ah, put a triangle inside and turn it. Now spin the circle, and what have you got? Yes, a sphere. The shape of things is first discovered in the mind. Slice off the top, and we have
a magnifying glass.
That's right. A lens is a section of a sphere. All optical instruments are created through mathematics. You see, there's a lot more to mathematics than just numbers and equations. Let's get back to our circle and triangle. Roll it, and we have
a wheel.
The circle has been the basis for many of man's important inventions. The mind can create the most amazing things. If we spin the triangle, we have
a cone.
Slice the cone. The cone is full of useful mathematical shapes. Slice it again. Slice it several times. The orbits of all planets and satellites can be found in the cone. No matter how you slice it, it's always mathematics. A slice like this gives us the reflector of a searchlight. A slice like this, the mirror of a giant telescope. A line on a cone, and we have a drill. And a spring. Now you're ticking. Is the birthplace for all of man's scientific achievements. The mind knows no limits when used properly. Think of a pentagram, Donald. Now put another inside, a third, and a fourth. No pencil is sharp enough to draw as fine as you can think, and no paper large enough to hold your imagination. In fact, it is only in the mind that we can conceive infinity. Mathematical thinking has opened the doors to the exciting adventures of science. Each discovery leads to many others, an endless chain.
What's the matter with these doors? These doors won't open. They're locked.
Of course they are locked. These are the doors of the future, and the key is...
mathematics.
Right. Mathematics. The boundless treasures of science are locked behind those doors. In time, they will be opened by the curious and inquiring minds of future generations. In the words of Galileo, mathematics is the alphabet with which God has written the universe.